Hey guys, I'm here with Riley Olivia, Myra Rose, and Javel Lahiri. Okay, so here's the thing. I know your name. I just can't speak.
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't matter.
Okay, so the thing is that these are like my astrology friends, astrologer friends, and we're going to do a forecast for 2023 and see like what's the weather for 2023 going to be economically, politically, social media stuff, like whatever we're going to talk about and see what you can expect. So this is going to be three different perspectives, three different decades, three different like whatever. It's like we're just going to roll with it and see how it goes. So welcome aboard, guys.
Hey.
Hi.
Hey.
Okay, so where do you guys want to start? Okay, so where do you want to start? You want to start with like we're, you know, ending 2022, which was like we've been in a bitch of a couple of years. Okay, but I know like a lot of astrologers predicted like the coronavirus and stuff like that, and I don't know, it feels like there's going to be an interesting year up ahead. So like, let's talk about that.
Okay, I would say that I would call 2022 the last normal year.
Wow.
So I would actually say that 2020, 2021, the COVID thing was like a play acting dress rehearsal for the rest of the decade. Like it's not really, we haven't seen the actual crisis. Like that's my thing. Yeah.
Yeah.
But I agree. Yeah.
I take a different perspective. Mm-hmm. Okay. I actually think we're going to start seeing things change for the better. Finally, a lot of shadows come out. And what do we do after we see the shadows or go through the shadow work? We start to ascend. So with that comes symptoms, obviously, but I do feel like we're on a track now towards this huge shift that we've been waiting to see. So it's.
I would say Pluto in Aquarius is definitely a step in the right direction after things have been like a big logjam for a while. But in terms of changes to the like underpinnings of society, like basically, you know, there will be a pretty huge collapse of a lot of things during this decade, you know, as we move forward.
It's, okay, so let's get manifested results of that. Like what is Pluto in Aquarius? Like, okay, so my baby understanding of astrology, because I don't like astrology because it makes it seem like we're in a simulation, which we are in a simulation, but that's another story. We could talk about that later. I know.
How do you play the game, right?
It's game. And I know this is how people play the game, whatever. Like I said, I used to work at an art gallery and this like lady we represented was from the Rockefeller family, and she wouldn't allow me to be hired or talk to me until she looked at my charts and stuff. So like, I know that I know they use it. So we ought to use it for what's going on with us. So anyway, so it's like a cheat code to the whatever this is. But okay, so the further out planets, they move slower. So when they do change into different things, it's a broader effect that everyone feels. Whereas, you know, something that's closer to the moon, such as Mercury, goes around the moon like four times as fast as us, or five or however many times as fast as us. So
the sun, yeah.
Yeah. So that's like, you know, we feel the effects of that all year long kind of thing, whereas the other ones can stay in signs for decades or something. So what does this mean? When you say Pluto's going into Aquarius, age of Aquarius. Okay. What does this mean?
Okay. Well, we're just,
and when is this happening?
It's happening between, basically now. So it's like March, I think, is when it actually goes in to Aquarius for the first time since the end of the 18th century?
March 23rd, to be exact.
There we go.
Yeah.
So it's that cycle started like in 08, 09. I think at the end of 08 was when Pluto moved permanently into Sagittarius into Capricorn from Sagittarius.
And so 08 was a huge economic collapse. So that's,
and we're getting one now too, right? We start it and we end it with collapse of value.
Whenever Pluto moves, you feel it move. Like it's like an avalanche. So when Pluto moved into Capricorn in 2008, 2009, we felt that. So that's what is that economic collapse is because it first moved into Capricorn and out of Sagittarius. And so where that's where it's been since, okay, in Capricorn. And now it's moving out of Capricorn and we'll be moving into Aquarius. So that's where we're going to feel that huge avalanche again. So whenever, yeah, something like that moves, yeah, it's like almost cataclysmic and lots happens. Like lots begins to happen right when you start to feel it shift. And we're going through this, we're about to feel it shift. So, and we've been starting to feel that shift since the last couple of years, right? So like, it's really getting close now. So I think that's what he means.
It can be cataclysmic, but it can also go in other directions. So when Pluto went into Sagittarius, we got like huge economic expansion and like big rallies in the 1990s because there was optimism, right? So Sagittarius is like wants to place big bets on the future because it's very optimistic about the way things are going to turn out. And Capricorn is the opposite. It wants proof every step of the way. And so when Pluto went into Capricorn, all the debts were called in, right? And there was this huge credit crunch. So that was the character of it. And it's been like that all the way through. There's sort of people just looking for immediate payouts and they want gratification. They don't really have that optimism. They're sort of checking all the time, but there's a certain amount of greed because it's an earth sign and Capricorn wants, you know, it wants material benefits, you know, it wants it. So
it wants structure, order, hierarchy. It wants control and power. Everything Capricorn wants, it wants to make sure everyone has a place in society. So with that also comes, you know, economy, and just structure, politics. And so like that's kind of what we've seen, you know, come to light in the last, you know, since 2008, right? Mm-hmm. So it's interesting at this point. So
what does Aquarius want? Because that's what we're going into.
Right. So Aquarius they're both traditionally ruled by Saturn. So there's a certain amount of coldness and a certain amount of restraint that you get with both of them, but the character is very, very, very different because you get Cap as an earth sign, Aquarius as an air sign, and then the modern ruler is Uranus, so it likes big changes. It has a similar optimism to Sagittarius, like with Sagittarius about the future, but its character is more radical. And jump in, anybody, what they think.
Yeah, Riley, what do you think about this Pluto stuff?
So, for anybody just dipping their toes into astrology, setting a foundation, the way Pluto works is as he's moving through signs, when he first enters a sign, he is the destroyer. But what is he destroying? He only destroys that which no longer serves. And it takes him about 280 plus or take
248.
Years. Okay. Yeah. 248 to move through the entire zodiac. He's a slow moving planet. So the destruction, it's felt initially when he moves over into another sign, but it's stretched out and it's almost gentle in that way, or it's underground at first because he's also the excavator. He pulls out all that has been subconscious suppressed in that energy, whatever zodiac sign he's in. And then once he clears away and everything is ash and becomes basically fertilizer, then he's able to replace that which was taken away with something that's even better simply because it serves the evolutionary purpose of the collective, of humanity. Speaking of that, moving out of Capricorn, which was all about what you guys were just talking about, structures, elite, those who are authority figures or in control, systems, as well as the full-on like destiny of the whole, like the boundaries of the globe. He took those that were operating maliciously with selfish intent, with intention that was self-serving. he took all of that away and is taking it away. And that's actually what we're talking about with 2023, what Val was talking about, moving into finally these results are coming in, because there's been so much happening behind the scenes that's been covered up. And now it's like you can't hide it anymore. So when Aquarius comes in, Aquarius, it's kind of like the exact opposite of Capricornian energy. It's the collective, it's the humanitarianism, it's the rebellion, it's the shaking, it's the electric. It shocks you into a whole new reality. Whereas Capricorn maintains and is very steady and rooted and very goal oriented. Pluto moving into Capricorn completely shifted the goal, the evolutionary goal of the collective. With Aquarius, it's the actualizing of that into a more cosmic perspective. This is the joining of the cosmic community. And these are our first steps collectively, because here's the thing, Pluto doesn't just move in and then proceed through a sign. He kind of plays with it a little bit. He goes in and out. So it's not like when he moves in March, he's going to stay there and that's that. No, he stays in, gives us a taste, wets the palate, and then comes back through, because there are going to be things that temporarily slip through the cracks in terms of authority structures that he's not done yet with. He's not finished clearing house with that. So by the second half of 2023, he's going to be coming back into Capricorn, and it's a retrograde. So it's a reviewing, and it's a digging even deeper and gripping out the last vestiges of those weeds. But I don't mean weed, because that's a whole other topic. Okay. Weeds are actually not bad. They're really good for you. They're healthy. But it's the choking piece that he's getting out, because there's a chokehold on the collective and this attempt to consolidate this power and this total control that is not permitted or embraced or supported by the energy we're moving into. Therefore, it will not flourish and it will not be accomplished. So it will initially appear as if our greatest fears are coming to actuality, are coming to life, but it's not supported by the energy. So I hate to ruin the ending for this story for people and spoil it, but it is exactly what Miara and Val are talking about. It's like something to be excited about, that we're finally coming into these results of all of this internal work we've been doing at an individual level. It's collectively coming in. We've got the alchemy of the collective just coming to fruition finally through this potency of Plutonian energy moving through. So with Aquarius, there are light sides and dark sides, as with everything. So the light side is this community, this humanitarian, this celebration, this uniqueness, finally coming out, be your big bad self and show it and share it with the world and contribute our gifts to the collective and diversity, celebration of diversity. And then there's the dark side. It's the uniformity. It's the one size fits all. It's the technology used for controlling and manipulation and keeping everything in its box. It's that coldness that Val was talking about. It's that detachment, but not like the healthy kind of detachment. It's the total evacuation of emotion and feeling, which is part of what defines humanity and being human. It's part of the human experience. It's taking that element out, again, for purposes of control. And Pluto is about power. So these conversations are going to be coming to the forefront, as in we've got these incredible advances in technology coming up, and we're going to have a conversation about how we want to use them. And what is it? What does it mean to be human? What is a human? And then applying that.
Yeah. Okay. I like it. Okay, so I see as a non-astrology person, a bunch of shifts coming and play, like, I feel like social media is going through a, it's going through, like, you know, Elon Musk just bought Twitter, and then, like, everybody's like, oh, Twitter's gonna be awesome now. And I've been on Twitter for like a couple years now, and Twitter's all of, it's kind of sucking right now. Like, there's nothing good coming on my feed. It's just like, I already got my account banned for 48 hours, and it's supposed to be like all freedom of speech. And I'm going like, nah, this isn't what they're like. I feel like, I haven't signed into Facebook in 2 years. Like, I feel like there's some sort of, like, we don't have it yet, but there's something like not going on in the
right
way.
We're still,
like,
in the shadow of Mercury, you know, I'm sorry, Mars retrograde in Gemini. So it is Mercury and steroids, sorry, Mercury retrograde and steroids. So we're still in the phase of that. And the fact that a Twitter was acquired during this period while Mars was in retrograde in Gemini is actually the problem. It's what is going on with Twitter. And I do think that's what you're dealing with right now, is we're still in that phase. Like, this hasn't, like, it, Mars won't actually go direct until like mid-January. Of, you know, and then when Mars goes direct, it's still going to be in shadow phase because it's been in retrograde since last, like, the end of October. And so it's really trying to deal with getting information straight, information, you know, moving correctly, truth being truth, like the things that we say we actually mean, like, it's really a mess. It's been a mess since then. And so that's, I think, what you're experiencing with Twitter. Well,
I mean, all of social media for the last, like, since COVID era has been completely, like, we've got to really see censorship in action, like, you know. And so is that going to continue? What's that about?
There's that
so
too.
The Mars retrograde in Gemini is, like, it's been going on, what, for like 4 months or something like that? It's
since,
like,
the end of October. So like almost, you know, two now.
But the whole thing all together is like a 4 month sandwich. It's Mars retrogrades are really interesting because Mars impels people towards action. And it's like one of the most palpable retrogrades. I think I notice them a lot more than a Mercury retrograde.
It's much more powerful, especially in Gemini, you know.
Yeah, it's a cool, I think it's a cool combination personally, because Gemini is a good self-promoter, and then Mars in Gemini I think feels pretty good. But a retrograde, you know, it's like, because it's an air sign, it's sort of like a lot of mixed up communication about communication, right? So like the Twitter thing kind of makes sense that the drama's playing out now. I mean, you know, and also
To answer Nikki's question, though, I think we need to address her question, is as far as the social media goes, it's looking like with Aquarius, when Pluto moves into Aquarius, we will see more of that policing. I think that's a shadow aspect.
I would disagree big time.
More policing?
Big.
I would think
time.
That because there's going to be more AI installed, like the AI has been really worked on these last couple of years, and it's really going to be more installed. And that's part of the Pluto and Aquarius, is we're going to see more of a rise in AI. Okay. So with AI already in place, it's not so much what were those people called that they were policing on Facebook?
Fact checkers.
Yeah, they were. Right. That's all. The algorithm has already been entered by them. So now AI will take over. So it'll be much more systemized and automated.
Okay, so here's the thing, though.
My hunch is I think that stuff obviously is going to happen, but my hunch is the Pluto crisis is going to play out very differently.
Well, because
eventually, but right now we're still in like the dismantling of the system.
And I would disagree about
Pluto's
going to
still go into
Capricorn
again.
Fast. Pluto's not real subtle. We're going to find out like in the next few years, basically.
Well, Pluto's not going to be completely Aquarius until next year. So we're only getting a taste of it, right? Coming up.
I don't think what's happening right now has anything to do with Pluto and Aquarius until it's actually there. Once it's there permanently, which is like the end of 24 or something like that, then we're going to see. Because you get Aquarius as an air sign, the guy's got the jug and he's pouring out the information. It's the economic model of Aquarius is like torrenting, basically. It's like the opposite of a scarcity principle. So it's like the more somebody wants something, the more it's available. And I just don't see how any way they're going to be able to control the ability of people to communicate anything they want any way they want.
Okay. Once, well, they're going to try. That's the they're going to try. And that's because that's how the AIs have been installed. However, because Pluto operates the way it does, it's going to catapult us to start a new, like a more, you know, Aquarius based platform for us to run ourselves. So that's how it will work. So first we need that, you know, the catalyst, right? Which would they've been installing while Pluto was in Capricorn. And right. like I said, it's coming back into Capricorn. So that taste of the Pluto Aquarius is what we're going to see, what's going to happen with the AI or however the people, you know, backlash from it or what we're going to see happen from that. But it's going to be like a major play out. And then as Pluto goes back into Aquarius next year, we're going to see these new innovative platforms that are going to be more societal run, more community based, less, you know, hierarchical structure like we've been. Like Twitter is run by, you know, Silicon Valley, Facebook, all that. It's going to go away. Because mm-hmm. that's not going to support the new, you know, Pluto and Aquarius structure, which again is not going to happen until next year. So for this next year, we're still going to see probably more of that shadow aspect, as I'm saying, of the AI algorithm bot, you know, controlling what you do on social media.
I do feel like, I mean, like I even just got like a big shout out from this Jimmy Bright Insight guy, and he had this, the video I got shouted out in got 1.2 or 3, I don't even know what it's up to right now, million views. And I gained 3,000 followers. Like statistically it does. And I was kind of like, that's kind of weird. Like I was like, not to sound like bitchy, but I was kind of expecting a little bit, like I would get more like statistical wise, but then like I looked at like my count and it, and then I looked at it like, I don't know, like 30 minutes later and it had gone down 150 people. Like, so like they are literally taking away, as people are subscribing, they're taking away. And like, I started screenshotting it because it's like a two-step. It's like, I'll get four, I'll lose two. And the thing is like, this is all like a bunch of, you know, fuckery that's going on with all these social media stuff. But eventually you're going to get people who are going to go like, all right, I don't want to play in your game. Then I don't want to play in your system. Like I'm not going to, like, if Twitter or whatever this thing is, YouTube or whatever, does this kind of shit to me forever, I really will just like leave it and go to Bumble or Rumble or whatever. Sorry, Rumble and like Odyssey or BitChute or whatever. At some point, like you can only mess with people so much, and you can only repress me so much, to where I'll be like, okay, well, I'm creating something for you. If you're just going to take it away from me, then I will go to another platform. So it's kind of, I do see that happening where things are, it just doesn't seem to me like this repression cannot stand, man.
Yeah. Well, it's totally. So it's like a shorthand way of talking about it in terms of what we're saying with Pluto. Is a really, really simple way to talk about Pluto and Capricorn. I mean, I love Capricorn. It's probably like my favorite sign, actually, for people. So I don't want to say that I hate
Capricorn. Is that Capricorn. The last one of the zodiac, Capricorn?
Well, no. Technically it's Pisces, but you know, then you start over again with Aries. So.
It's the last Earth sign. The last of the year. Yeah. It's December.
It's wrapping
ends
up Earth, yeah. Okay. But the just a shorthand way of saying it is Capricorn's really uptight, and Aquarius is just like very rebellious. So there's going to be a lot of people reacting to any attempts at control, and because Pluto's there, it's going to fuel a lot of energy in favor of alternatives succeeding. There's mm-hmm. going to be alternative ways of doing pretty much everything, and they're going to have a big boost with that planet there, just concentrating energy in the direction of all kinds of viable alternatives. And right now we're locked into thinking that there aren't options because that scarcity principle is there. So that, you know, I mean, there's a lot of other stuff happening besides Pluto. Pluto's like the big thing that I'm aware of, but there's like so much other stuff. And the Mars retro is just so much fun right now. It's like, you know, I love retrograde planets. I love it. I love
okay, Mars so Mercury retro goes favorite. Retrograde 4 times a year always, or just this year?
I mean, it did it in 2022 and it's doing it again in 2023. Typically, it's only 3 times a year. But this year, or 2023, so 2022, he retrograded 4 times and every time it was in an air sign. So air signs are connected.
Wait, I'm sorry, can I interrupt? Are we talking about Mercury or Mars?
Mercury.
Mercury, okay.
Yeah.
Sorry, my bad.
No. So Air signs are connected to the mental body. They're connected to thoughts, communication, relationships, strategy, everything connected to mechanisms of the mind. So there was a lot that happened pertaining to that department of life across a couple of different departments of life. But Mercury represents our communication, our thoughts, the way we process information, the way we receive information, the way we give information, et cetera. So it was a very information heavy, kind of discerning year. It was practice though. That was a really important thing that was mentioned at the beginning of this, how we haven't really gone into anything just yet. It's like, you know, we were in the batting box for the past 3 years or so. This time, this year, Mercury is getting real because he is retrograding again four times, but it's in all the earth signs. So right now he's in Capricorn retrograding. Then in, hold on, I wrote it down. That's until January 18th. Okay. Then April 21st to May 15th, he retrogrades in Taurus. That's another earth sign. Then August 24th until September 16th, he retrogrades in Virgo. By December 13th, he'll retrograde again in Capricorn, but he'll retrograde all the way back into Sagittarius, much like I think he's actually going to do this time around as well. The point is that's a major difference in energy. So while the air signs are about mental body structures, the earth signs are about matter, about tangible results, about physical reality, rooted reality.
So is that like natural disasters kind of thing, or?
Well, especially with that Taurus energy going on in April, absolutely. Every time we see, I mean, we've got Uranus in Taurus this whole year as well. And he has been for quite some time. He's another very heavy, large planet that takes a while to get through the sign. We don't have to get into him just yet, but with that combination of Uranus and Mercury together in Taurus, in that earth sign, Taurus is directly connected to the earth. Think earthquake. Think ground shaking. But again, I don't think it's going to be like cataclysmic. It's simply Earth moving herself, situating herself, kind of like adjusting her position a bit. So I do see some parts of the world experiencing that in a stronger, more intense way than other parts of the world. But Taurus is also connected to money and the economy. And when Mercury retrogrades in Taurus, it causes us to rethink money, rethink values, relax into those, review our actual needs. Because that's the other cool thing about Taurus. Taurus always simplifies. He brings it back to core. What do I absolutely need? And what can I just let go and release to lighten my load and just get back to the basics?
Cool.
It is pretty cool.
Any other thoughts on the Mercury retrogrades?
I'm not a good guy for Mercury retrogrades. I was born with like Mercury basically stationary in Pisces. So I'm just like,
Mercury retrogrades don't bother me either.
Yeah. Yeah. Are they like triggers for bigger things, I guess, is the best way to look at it. And they're, I just love retrogrades. I just love them. Mm-hmm. They're cool.
That's a good thing to bring up, though. If someone has Mercury retrograde in their natal or station direct, it's like Mercury retrogrades are just like, hey, everyone else is on my page now. And it's like, it doesn't, you know what I mean? It doesn't really, but when it hits another planet in the same sign, I think what Riley was saying, it really does make a difference. So
totally. Oh, yeah.
I think she covered it.
Yeah. There's a lot of things that slip by me because I'm paying attention to the stuff that's far out. And I'm a slow moving person in general. Anyone that knows me can confirm that. So I miss the details
So Val's really interested in Eris or Eros. How do you say that?
Eris.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Eris. Oh, Eris. That's interesting. There, that Eris makes a cool conjunction to the North Node at the end of the year. Did you see that?
I guess it would have to. Yeah.
Yeah. Know. It's like the download I got from that was hell has no fury like a woman something. There was like something there about like the angry feminine coming out at the end of the year, but I mean I don't know if we want to jump to that yet.
Yeah, Eris is a whole big bag. I mean, like Eris I see as basically just being about justice and
It made me think there's something might be happening at the end of the year next year in terms of like what they're with women's rights or something like that. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't think Eris functions exclusively with women. I think it kind of comes on in that guise. I actually think of Eris as being a masculine planet and Pluto as being a feminine planet. So Eris,
I agree about Pluto being feminine. I haven't really seen Eris as masculine because it's like, isn't she portrayed as like, or it portrayed as like a warrior woman?
Yeah, Eris in astrology, in my opinion, has nothing to do with war. It's really about sharing. It's about a process of sharing. And it's basically extroversion. So when we talk about masculinity or femininity in astrology, it's really about extroversion versus introversion. It's not about manliness versus femininity or anything like that. So Eris, in my mind, my view of it is very much, it's sort of like probably like the most extroverted planet. It wants to share everything. So social media is a manifestation of the discovery of Eris, right? Because 2005 it was discovered, and then social media basically just exploded right after that. I mean, it had kind of been bubbling up since the beginning of the internet, but it really found its footing, you know, in that second half of the 2000s decade. And so I don't know, North Node conjunct Eris to me would be a really great time for sharing in general. I mean, you're sharing yourself with other people and you start to immediately get into ethics, and then justice kind of comes out of that. So it's just very socially engaged. So that's why I call it masculine, because it's very extroverted. And I call Pluto feminine because it's at its best when you're working sort of therapeutically on yourself. You know, you go inside yourself, you don't need any rules. You just kind of dig in and do anything to dig out that hidden power within you. And then Pluto is a little weirder when it's going out into the world, because it can be very exploitive. So like Eris itself is hard when you're just going inside, because you're not meant to be isolated with Eris. You're meant to be sharing stuff with other people.
Is Eris further out than Pluto?
Yeah, it's way out there.
So how? What's its rotation around the sun?
It's got a 560-year orbit, 559 years.
Wow, it's like twice as long as Pluto.
It's way out there. And it's coming back from its furthest point. So it's like, it's almost 100 times the distance between Earth and the sun. It's just way, way out there. Yeah, and it's creeping back into the public, you know, it's creeping back into the public consciousness basically now.
So can I piggyback off this conversation? We're talking about this masculine feminine energy is interesting to me, especially with Pluto. I always see Pluto as a feminine too, because Pluto rules Scorpio, and Scorpio is a water sign. But anyway, regardless, it's so interesting how the nodes are going to shift, right? In July, like July, 18th. The nodes are going to shift out of, you know, where they've been right now in Taurus and Scorpio into Aries and Libra. And, you know, with Libra being the South Node, it is about that balance, you know, the divine union. So it is interesting how we're going to be coming from that place and into like leading us into a place of, you know, going into our individuality through the Aries North Node. How do we move into individuality? How do we move into starting new, beginning things differently in our own way, through our own lens? But what's interesting is right after the nodes move is Venus, the ruler of the South Node of Libra, goes into retrograde, like almost like, I don't know, just 5 days after, moves into retrograde in Leo. And so Venus in Leo is really strong, but in retrograde, it's like really this kind of like retrospective on relationships, on, you know, one's passion and creativity. And I don't even know how long is she going to be in retrograde for. I think quite a while.
It's a bit.
So that's going to be, you know, that's going to be really hard for us to kind of go through. Oh, also the nodes at the same time in July. July's a lot, lots happening, but the nodes in July will then be squaring Pluto. And the that kind of square of the nodes to Pluto is really a power play. It's like a play in passion and power obsession, even like going against societal norms. So it's like really a breaking out. There's like a huge agitation happening in July with, you know, people who maybe have been used to being more cooperative, compliant, you know, being a little bit more focused on relationship or the others around them are now going to maybe feeling the agitation, you know, and ready to kind of move into, you know, that also people who, you know, wherever the North Node has been in your chart, as you know, it's, there's a lot of like lots of things that have been happening in Taurus. Whoever, you know, wherever Taurus is in your chart, like that's going to be a huge activity, right? And then and when the node moves into Aquarius, it's like a push forward. It's like finally like the momentum that's necessary to kind of go off on your own and do your own thing and start fresh and new. And I don't know if you guys want to talk about, you know, with that comes the Jupiter moving into it, that Jupiter that moved into Taurus. I think we that was in
what's up with Taurus? Feels like there's a lot of Taurus stuff.
Yeah, there's been a lot because Taurus has been the ruler of the North Node for the past year and a half, right? Or last year, technically. Yeah. And the nodes are really important because they're like ecliptics of the moon, right? So, and you know, we go by the moon, we like really kind of feel the moon. The moon is like one of it's not really a planet, it's a luminary, but we feel it the most. So when you bring in the nodal points, like it really kind of highlights what we're going through as a collective and in our personal life. And so with Taurus being the ruler of the North Node, it has really been about relationships and money because that rules Venus, right? And Venus is about relationships and money. So we've been really experiencing that in our own, you know, individual lives and through a collective with that. And so Venus is also the ruler of the South Node. That's going to be changing next year. So we're not getting rid of Venus. Venus is coming in strong and she's going to show us, you know, how we assess what we've been doing with money and relationships the past year and a half. Because now with the South Node, it's like a reaper of karma, right? Of destiny. So whatever we've been doing with relationships and money in the past year and a half is now going to show us the next year and a half what we have to show for it. Like we're going to reap the benefits or the rewards of that South Node energy, right? So that Venus is still going to be coming in hot the next year and a half. So we're got to get nice and comfortable with Venus and Venusian energy, which again rules money and relationships.
Yes, but also
go ahead.
Piggybacking on that, if you were to look at the chart as if it was a compass, the nodes are the arrow of that compass. So the North Node is pointing north. It's the direction we are headed collectively, whereas the South Node is what's getting toned down. The air is kind of pulling off of the South Node. So while Venus was turned all the way up volume-wise because she's the ruler of Taurus, which has been the North Node, it's been the direction for the past year, now she'll be moving into that South Node resonance because she also rules Libra, which is another conversation because actually the true ruler of Libra is Vulcan, which is a masculine energy, but that has not been discovered yet.
That big 10.
Beautiful. So she's going into the backseat. So she was up at the front. She was in the kitchen. She was cooking it up. She was serving it up. She was being hospitable, being the hostess. And now she's going into the back and cleaning up and cleaning all those dirty dishes and putting the house back together, throwing things out, taking out the trash. And this is what gets interesting. Suddenly Mars steps up as the main role, who takes the lead, because Aries is what moves in, or the North Node moves into Aries and Mars rules Aries. So it's going from this feminine receiving, pulling in, just beautification relationships. And we're heading into this very masculine, like you were saying, Val, giving, going forward, providing and diving into whatever head first.
Mm-hmm. Okay. It sounds good.
Okay, so are we going to have any nuclear weapons or any wars anymore? Like, what do you guys think about all that?
Nope, it's all talk. It's all talk.
Oh, well, I don't even think nukes are real.
Energy is there.
Uranium's a different story, though. Energy sources, that's a different conversation. Nuclear war, absolutely not.
Oh.
He disagrees.
Okay, so 2023, perhaps not, but in this decade going forward, it's definitely going to be an issue. I would love to be wrong, but I would expect
everything nuclear
is going to be way, way, way big time on everybody's mind
as a useful resource, not so much as a destructive one.
Okay, so
I'm sorry to say that everything about it is going to be on the table. I don't want to be right about that because I prefer to live in a planet where there isn't nuclear war. But it sure as hell is going to be a thing. It's good. Somebody somewhere is going to want to try to blow something up.
Okay, but wanting and doing are two different things. But also,
wanting and doing in this case, I want to clarify. I think it's pretty likely somebody's going to do it. There's going to be probably at least one that goes off. I hate saying it. I'm just telling you. This is what I think is going to happen. I don't think it's going to happen next year. But I think
what about free energy? Because but some other kind of energy.
Yeah,
source,
As y'all were saying, free energy is the upside to that. Yeah, like Myra was just saying that's definitely happening too. So that's one of the big economic shifts with Pluto and Aquarius, is we get out of scarcity mindset. So we're really locked up in that right now. Pluto takes so long that people just think everything's going to stay that way. And then it changes, you know, things change. So I'm old. So I can remember the early 90s, right? And people were just saying that, you know, the future's going to be boring and we're going to have to deal with less. And like my generation of people, because I'm in my 50s. So we were saying, you know, we're going to be living like just this very modest existence compared to our parents. And I remember that was all over the news because we were finishing this cycle of Pluto and Scorpio. And for whatever reason, it kind of ended on this very somber note and then went into Sag. And then immediately we got all these billionaires popping out and the internet was exploding and technology, people had all this faith. Anyway, I'm getting sidetracked, but I just say that it, you know, everything nuclear is going to be there. So the good side and the bad side, both will be there.
You know, like I'm no astrologer and I'm no psychic, but I'm just like a think I know it all person. And like, I do feel that I remember being 18 going, nothing new is ever going to be invented. Like I have my Walkman and I'm good, but like, right. And then along comes the, you know, whatever the little pocket computers we carry around. Right. But, world's knowledge at your fingertips, even though it's censored. But now I feel like, I do feel like we're going to go through some sort of huge industrial revolution of a new kind of way of doing energy. I don't know that I'm going to be right about it, but I just feel it because it's got to be about magnets,
I don't know. Yeah. I think the free energy thing and the idea of the positive side of nuclear power, the availability of something that way that sort of changes the underpinnings of everything. It just seems like it's got to come to the surface with Pluto and Aquarius. I just don't see how it couldn't. And if there isn't a nuclear bomb that goes off somewhere, what I would say is that there'll be a lot of attention on that as a problem. And
well, I mean, there already is.
Now, I would argue that there really isn't. I think people are super flaky. The people that are in power right now have just completely taken that out of, it's just barely creeping into the public discussion right now, but in a really childish way. I mean, it's just saying, you know, they're saying, oh, some other guy somewhere is going to blow us up. So we better get our nuclear arsenal together to make sure that they don't do it. And that's an infantile mindset. I mean, like when I was a teenager in the 80s, people have been living with the prospect of nuclear war for decades. And they got to a point where people were generally aware that they didn't want it, you know, and then somehow it got off the table and it's not really being dealt with. I think it's going to be dealt with again. You know, it's just whether the lesson's going to be hard or easy. You know, either it's going to happen, possibly not happen.
When is that going to happen? do you think? Like you said, sometime in this decade, not necessarily.
Yeah, I think things are going to get, I don't want to derail this. I'll just say very quickly. I think things are going to get really, really, really hairy in the rest of the decade with Pluto square. There's a dwarf planet called Haumea. And Haumea is very, 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 very powerful and not really understood. And that square between Pluto and Haumea, in my opinion, is going to be really, really, really rocking the world for the rest of the decade, because it's holding a square pattern throughout the rest of the decade. So we're in the beginning of it now. We've been in it for a year. And it's just, the really short way to say it is Haumea is basically like Mother Nature, in my opinion. And so Haumea is a planet that.
Okay, well,
really
then what about pole shifts?
Yeah, I mean, there's so many different variations of that. You can look at the sun, you can look at geomagnetism, you can look at like the earth, polar shifts. I mean, just to say it's nuclear, it's like actually like putting it on man when that's Mother Nature, because nuclear is more man.
No, the nuclear thing is talking about Pluto, and that's a human exploration of the thing. So Pluto is ruling very, very intense concentrations of attention that go dig into something like with a microscopically fine point and explode a hidden power that's inside of it. So that fixation on nuclear power is guaranteed to happen this decade. It could also manifest in terms of nuclear weapons. I think both of those things are 100% guaranteed to be major, major elements of this coming decade. When I'm talking about Haumea, I'm talking about Mother Nature, a force of nature that's acting at a square at cross purposes to Pluto. Pluto is a rascal, okay? Pluto, the way it operates in the world, is a rascal. It doesn't give a F about any rules. It just wants what it wants. It's going to get it any way it possibly can. So Mother Nature has a bigger plan for us that we don't really know about, right? Haumea is basically a planet that puts humanity in its place and tells us that a human being isn't really the last thing that's here. So if you really want to know, in the coming decade, there's going to be mutations to the human organism that are going to create a new version of a hominid. And going forward in the like centuries to come, there's going to be a new version of a human being, and we're going to be like the Neanderthals living with that new human being.
Okay, that's so coming out of the square between
Pluto and Haumea.
Well, that's where I wanted to take it, actually, because we're talking about all this technology that's externalized. No, the real technology that Pluto in Aquarius is talking about is the secrets of the human body and the technology that is the body and the genetics and DNA and the true power of that and the history of that. That's another component we haven't touched on yet. Our history books are getting exploded. They're going to be forever changed because information is going to be coming out, not necessarily externalized information. We're talking memories. We're talking things getting activated in the human body that were like, whoa, oh my, I just remembered that occurrence, that thing. Where is it in the history? What is going on here? Whoa. And it's literally like waking up from hypnosis that we've all been under for quite some time. And so this whole idea and concept of the new human, it's very literal. We're talking physical changes. And so that can be interpreted as nuclear explosion and mutilation of the human body. No. Because as we established earlier, this whole energetic turning it's embracing and endorsing the upswing of things, the ascension direction of things, not the devolution, not the descension. We already did that. We're on the upswing now.
I mean, you could choose. This is the thing. This is like a bifurcation.
Exactly.
You can choose which way you want to go. At this point, it's our choice. And especially we'll see that more and more as Uranus goes into Gemini. It will be our choice, which path we take. It's up to us. Like not everyone's going to ascend. It's just going to be a force of will at this point. What do you will your future to be? And we talk about, Dolores Cannon's the shifting and the splitting of the earth, that kind of thing. We bring in that whole concept. as we move into that bifurcation process right now with the ascension process. So
yeah, exactly. And
sorry,
so
technology, interrupt you, Riley.
No, that was beautiful. Agree with you,
but I know there's people that completely disagree, and I want to address the splitting of realities have been really happening these past couple of years, and we're going to see it more and more. And that's like a perfect example right there. It's like someone's going to see, oh, we're ascending, while the other person's going to be like, well, no, we're going to be dying. And it's like that's definitely the splitting of the realities of the perceptions of, you know, what our experience is going to be like.
Okay, but do you think that that's going to be like what are we talking about? Like, is it like, we're going to get manipulated, or some of us are like, there's going to be this solar flash and some of us are going to be able to like deal with shit and other ones are not? Like, you're actually going to have like
our like DNA. Or dimensional shift.
We
get totally missed Saturn in Pisces. Can we talk about that is happening this year? Cause that is karmic repercussions of past choices. Okay. If we want to talk about, you know, but DNA manipulation and how that's going. And what the future of that holds, we'll start to see the repercussions of that this year. So, you know, we want to think of what our DNA is doing. And of course, what our DNA is doing in response to the planetary shifts in the sun, you know, the solar flares, the coronal mass ejections we've been experiencing have really been affecting our bodies, right? And our body is very Taurus. Again, we've been in Taurus kind of body signature, but like it's really affecting reality. So when we think about DNA manipulation, what is going to be some kind of repercussion? Because Saturn, as it comes into Pisces, we're going to see repercussion of, you know, toxic spirituality. And we're also going to see how we're going to approach spirituality in a responsible way. Like, what does that mean to be, you know, someone who enmeshes themselves in that spiritual understanding, belief, ascension process? Like, what does that even mean? You know, like how much of this, you know, frou-frou kind of fluffy bunny language are we going to take and not take responsibility for? Like, what does it actually mean? And like, really assess it. And like, what are we doing to our reality? And are we in la-la land? Or, you know, what does that mean for us in an ascension process? Like, what does that mean? Do we take care of our bodies? Do we take, you know, how do we handle our DNA? You know, how do we handle our health, you know, in terms of our emotional health or our spiritual health? So I think that's really an interesting, we're going to start seeing that this year.
Yeah, it's an interesting combination of Saturn and Pisces. It's a weird one.
It is. It'll be very fascinating. Yeah. I mean, some really great literature and movies and that kind of thing that, you know, people it makes you take fantasy and really ground it into what is that actually doing? What does it actually mean? But that also, you know, really does translate into this kind of spiritual process that we've been undergoing.
I think like the last time we had that was like early mid 90s. And then the time before we had Saturn in Pisces was like mid 60s. Mm-hmm. And so they're both like, those are both periods of time in terms of pop culture. And
Dune was created.
We went to the moon in 68, right?
Right, but that
exactly.
It's a period of time where there's a lot of dreaming and there's a lot of introspection, is what I would say about those two cycles before that I'm aware of.
Dreams coming to life, being actualized.
A lot of interesting music was made during both.
That's kind of primarily what I was thinking. Is then the mid 90s was also very interesting for not necessarily just music, but lots of creativity.
Yeah. So it's a way to ground in, you know, Pisces with that Saturn aspect to Pisces.
Well, I'll tell you where there has not been a lot,
but it's also very karmic.
Not like lately. Music. Yeah.
A lot of recycling in the arts, I've noticed.
Yeah, very much. It's like they don't have any new ideas. So they just
hopefully you'll bring in new things that could be really exciting, like new kinds of art, new kinds of music that, you know, we'll see that could be different.
Yeah. It's another Pluto and Capricorn thing, in my opinion, is recycling the old stuff, going back to the well.
Yeah, what works, what makes the money, right? Mm-hmm. What's successful? Just follow the formula. Yeah.
Yeah, and people are burning out on it for sure. I mean,
it's just boring. It's not interesting anymore. It's not fresh. It's not new. It's not inspiring.
Right.
Bring in the Aquarius, please.
I mean, it's like I would rather watch YouTube videos on megalithic rocks all day than like, and I literally do, versus watch a TV show or movies, because it's just the same, like Joseph Campbell's, like, you know, hero, victim, like savior complex, like cycle over and over and over again. And I'm like, cool.
But you know, you know, that's drugs, actually, sorry, I was gonna say drugs is a huge part of that. I was gonna change the whole thing.
Well, I was just gonna say, just to kind of bookend that, what you just said, Nikki, is that is really interesting, considering we are pulling out of the age of Pisces. Again, it's not like a switching, flicking the switch thing. It is a gradual, very like ombre-ed process where we're pulling out of Pisces.
When are we officially in the age of Aquarius? When does that officially complete?
That is a contested point among all astrologers for the entire history of time.
Open up a can of worms with that one.
Yeah, I think we're at least a generation away from it. I think we're a ways away from
it. I don't even believe that's a real thing.
Yeah, yeah. I'm starting to wonder if it's a real thing too. Yeah, I'm starting to question it, because it gets into something called precession, which is this 25,000 year cycle.
Okay, I was going to ask about that.
Yeah, and the thing is, to have any kind of confidence or certainty about precession, it basically requires a civilization to be hundreds of thousands of years old, which may be true. I mean, maybe that may be true, is that we've got the legacy of that thing, but we don't really know.
But even if it's true, we don't have active.
There's the thing is, we don't really know how we got it or where it came from. It's just sort of this hazy thing of this 2000 year thing. And we can track it with our technology and say, yeah, this seems right, but how did we know it? And how do we have the ability to talk about it? And that break in the continuum, that where we don't really know where we came from, whatever information about the exact cusp of those things is, because the constellations themselves are not exactly even. You know, we look at the zodiac like there's 12 30 degree chunks.
There are no walls to constellations.
They're different sizes. There's like giant ones and little ones, and so it's just like.
Okay, so not to be too devil's advocate-y, but like, how can we even trust the nature of the astrology that we're given to begin with? Meaning like, who's the primary, where did we get, I mean, this information apparently is the source of it is kind of like, meh.
I think when you just use it and you look at people's charts and you look at things,
it starts matching up.
It becomes really clear that it's there. I mean, I've never had a chart lie. So it works, then it's like a wheel, right? I didn't invent a wheel, but I use it every day.
Okay, I like that.
Yeah.
I can get down with that.
So yeah, I mean, it's very different than like when you're looking at constellations than when you're looking at planetary signatures, you know, on an astrology wheel, when you're looking at their interactions, their aspects, their patterns. That's more specific, that's more detailed, so that you can actually measure something like a constellation or like an age, you know, age of Pisces, age of Aquarius. You can't really measure that. So it's really hard to say, oh, it's this is when it begins, this is when it ends. But with things like signatures and, you know, that's how I've actually even gotten into astrology, is because I was trying to make sense of my reality and what was happening. And it made sense to me. It made sense why certain things were happening in certain times of my life, right? So what we're doing is we're doing more mundane astrology. So we're applying these things to a general scope of the population and the planetary kind of aspect. So that can sometimes be where things can be a little bit hazy and fuzzy and not so detailed and particular, like in a natal birth chart, right? So it's all very, you know, specific when it comes to the natal birth chart. It's very different than when we're looking at a mundane horoscope forecast here.
Yeah,
and,
I mean,
and
go for it. Regarding the zodiac, I just say that it's another one of those things. There's controversy about what exactly it is. I mean, it could be actually something that's coming from the Earth, because we've got the signs are oriented towards the solstices and the equinoxes. You know, that's how we measure them. And then the ages is something else that's sort of rolling backwards in the opposite direction. And it's a little harder for us to understand what that is and how it's working. The constellations may be beaming the stuff in from the outside, but it might actually be something that's just innate to Earth and coming out from the planet, or a combination of both. I mean, I've heard recent explanations where I don't know if you know, like Dan Winter and the people that do these things. Yeah. So they have an explanation where they think neutrinos. I've heard people say that where the neutrinos are passing through the planet when it's in a certain part of the sky, then that's how the energy of the constellations, the energy of the signs comes into, you know, have its effect on people. I mean, I think people don't really know. It's like, it's just, and
you know, it's not like we're just like in a universe, like spinning around like that. I mean, we're also moving within the universe as well. Like,
you know, the thing that makes the procession very, very complicated, like as to how that, what that is and how we can know it. And I mean, it seems to me like there's something there, but I go back and forth every day thinking about that one. You know, how real it is.
Yeah, because I mean, I was going to say basically I was going to say, okay, when's the thing that I incarnated for going to happen? Like, when is this big giant catalyst
happening now?
I would agree with that. Like everything related to self-realization and ascension and all those things, I think of those as things that are very individual and they can be, it's a constant thing. It's every moment that possibility is there, you know. And we may be in the age of Pisces because there's a lot of passivity in it. You know, that's one of the downsides of Pisces. Like when you're getting into the end of anything, you get some of the negatives there. You know, you get some of the downsides because you're getting ready for something new. And there's just a lot of individual passivity in the world. You know, we're kind of programmed to see reality as a TV show or a movie. So it's like, we're waiting for the thing to happen. It's like, well, do it, you know. Like,
and that's the Aries North Node. I mean, that's my North Node. We're moving into. Just do it, man. Yeah. Stop waiting for other people and stop, you know, waiting around for other people.
Right. Yeah.
Well, so this is what's also interesting about the shifting of ages is also an evolutionary shift of collective consciousness on like a universal scale, which is exciting. But that big kind of movement, that big kind of shifting, it's like shifting the playing field or the playing board of the planetary experience. So like, you know, different souls, we can get into all of that at another point in time. But the point here is shifting into this consciousness of Aquarius, there are clues, there are signs, there are indications inherent in the meaning of the energy of Aquarius that you can locate on a daily basis. They're kind of like signs as you're passing, driving by on the road, signs like Age of Aquarius this way, Age of Aquarius 2 miles ahead, Age of Aquarius coming up, you're almost there. And these signs are like these conversations about quantum mechanics, quantum physics. That's very Aquarian. These conversations about alternative methods, especially with health, that's a huge indicator that, oh, yep, we're pulling into the town or the city of Aquarius, and we're on our way, very much about to pull into some sort of parking lot situation. Now, of course, this is relative because we don't even need to get into the concept of time, but our now, it, you know, I'm not going to get into it. It's relative.
Well, I do think like time has changed throughout time. Like, I mean, if you look at the flora and fauna of before the last ice age, it's like it was super big. And like, we can either assume that the atmosphere was different, the air we breathed, maybe the magnetism of the planet was different, but maybe actually like time moved at a different rate to which you could have. And I'm not just talking about like dinosaurs, which I think are dragons, but like, I'm not even talking about like how big that stuff is. I'm talking about even just, or even we could talk about woolly mammoths or something, but I'm not talking about that. I'm not even talking about like pine leaves, or like you have like ginkgo leaves, like bigger than my body, you know, and now ginkgo leaves are like this big. Like something about the properties, and it could have involved time, were different on this planet. That's why I kind of question Kali Yugas and all that stuff as well. It's because I'm like, well, I don't think we're at, I don't even think that's stable. the way in which we experience time because of fossil records.
Yeah, we're measuring time in tens and hundreds of thousands of years. I mean, it's definitely not going to be accurate.
Yeah. Right. Well, we've had Saturn square Uranus for a while, and that's finally breaking up. So does anybody want to chip in, like put some stuff in about that?
We didn't talk about Jupiter going into Taurus at all, did we?
Yeah, a little bit.
We didn't talk about it.
Yeah, I mean, did it just pop into Aries again, like just now? Because it's moving real fast.
Yeah. It's definitely moving fast. It's going to be moving into Taurus in May.
Yeah.
Mid-May.
It's just like whizzing through, man. It's like, wow.
Okay, so what's Jupiter do for us? Okay, you guys are all astrology.
It's a gift giver.
So tell me, like, what's Jupiter mean for me, and where is it going, and how is that going to affect us?
Go ahead.
Am I doing it?
It's a big old party. Basically, whenever an astrologer sees Jupiter, they're like, okay. And they get really excited to tell you about, you know, what's going on with Jupiter in your chart.
He's a
gift giver.
Where the North Node and Uranus have been really agitating your chart the past couple of years, Jupiter's going to come in there and just kind of soothe you a little bit and give you a gift. Because basically the agitation that's been happening with that Taurus energy, Jupiter will come in and really bring in new gifts in that area to help you through that agitation that's been happening. Planetary wise, I mean, it's really funny because we talk about recession, but you know, we think about that. What it's almost going to be, what's the opposite of recession?
Expansion.
Yeah. No. With inflation, deflation. Oh, right. Well, okay, Jupiter and Taurus makes me think of deflation. With is opposed to inflation, so it's like it's almost like things will be. It almost be no value. I don't know, but that's really interesting. I don't know with Jupiter, just in Taurus, it's a lot of materialism. It's like a lot. It's just a big gift giver because you have Taurus, which is the material, you know, sign of food and physicality, of Venus, money, possessions, and in Jupiter, that's like, you know, expansion of those things. So I don't know. It makes me think, okay, well, is a recession really going to be happening the way we think it is? Like Jupiter's going to come in and like bring in something there. So I'm curious, what do you guys think about? How do you see that?
Well, it's on average, it's a 1 year trip through each sign. I mean, it doesn't exactly play out that way because it zigzags, it goes back and forth, retrogrades and stuff, but it's a relatively quick in terms of mega cycles, you know, in terms of the bigger things that are happening. I would love it if it would offset the food crisis, because the global food crisis is the thing that really alarms me more than anything. I mean, that's something that I would be pleasantly surprised if it doesn't increase during the coming years, you know. So it Jupiter in Taurus might offset it for a while and give us some chances to course correct, which would be great. Yeah,
because Taurus rules food too, right? Yeah. And yeah, so that's why it just makes me think, like, do I really want to believe this narrative that we're being fed right now, that we're in this like extreme recession and, you know, we're dire and everything's gonna like, you know, just we're just all going to be poor and miserable and like back to the Middle Ages or something. It's like, or is this something they're trying to implant in our consciousness, you know? And so it makes me really, again, take a look at, you know, the astrology, be like, well, you know, were the astrology saying this? So I'm curious what's going to happen. Of course, I'm always open-minded. I want to make one decision one way or the other, but I definitely want to keep that in mind, that Jupiter in Taurus is actually the opposite of recession.
Taurus also is connected to tangible resources. So you put Jupiter in there, it's an expansion of tangible resources across the board. Yeah. It's like abundance manifest, like think about what you need and it appears, materializes right in front of you. I mean, it's like that crazy.
Yeah. Yeah.
So like you were saying, Val.
That's what that guy, Amazon order, right?
Yeah. But it's connected to what you were saying, Val, about taking us out of this constricting lack scarcity mindset and kind of catapulting us into this, whoa, where did all this abundance come from? Turns out it's been there all along. You just weren't focusing on it. But here it is. You can't miss it anymore.
Yeah, I mean, I hate to be the, you know, I'm just saying it's offsetting a lot of the larger things in a positive way.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I mean, there's some real nefarious skullduggery at work, you know, regarding like the food supply on Earth and access to resources. And that's just a thing that's happening. So we've got Pluto in Aquarius giving.
That's Pluto Capricornian type stuff too. Again, it's like the manipulation and the control and, you know, so it's, I mean, again, it's because we're going to be seeing more Pluto and Capricorn in this next year. It'll be interesting.
Yeah, it's definitely Pluto and Capricorn is one of the major actors there, but the vectors of those problems will still be with us in different forms. So like one of the downsides to Pluto and Aquarius is it's going to be, right? We've all heard the people in Switzerland, right? The boring
World Economic Forum.
The gas bags that like to get up and talk about how they're fixing everybody's problems, right? And how they say they've got this line, you'll own nothing and be happy. Right. So unfortunately, that is kind of a Pluto.
That's what they're trying. They're trying to pull like.
Well, they're trying. I know, but what I'm saying is that they're going to continue to try because
they can try all they want.
They are going to be trying all they want. It's basically what I'm saying is that it's that vector is still there, even though there's going to be lots of alternatives and solutions that we don't think are there right now that are suddenly going to be manifesting. That battle of those people to try and control things and create scarcity is unfortunately going to be continuing and taking a different form.
They're trying to really push because they know, because Pluto is going to leave Capricorn next year. They're trying to do everything they can before the 2024. When Pluto moves into Aquarius, they don't have a chance. You know, but like, I think AI will come in and take over them. You know what I mean? And then they're up against AI.
I think it's going to get a lot wilder. I agree. I think that's cool. I mean, I think it's going to get a lot wilder than it's been, but the battle
is going to be Wild West sure.
Yeah. Well, I think what Val might be alluding to is there are a bunch of variables that are not accounted for yet because they have not entered the stage. So
right, stuff that hasn't. Yeah. Right. Yeah. We have yet to see how it's going to. Yeah.
Like paradigm shifting, either pieces of technology.
Watch people become breatharians overnight and say, we don't need food.
kind of like that. I'm not saying exactly that, but that's a great example of something that completely changes the board. Completely.
Yeah, you could get people doing something like that with Pluto and Aquarius. Actually, you really could. You could end up having a breatharian sect somewhere. That could totally happen.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of leeway for all kinds of out there things, you know, things that just no one would believe are possible now that will be manifested.
Yeah. What about astrology wise, like, could we have I don't know, like inner earth beings or like breakaway civilizations exposing themselves to us or like dimensional aliens is that anywhere in the cards ever?
I think that's a guarantee in the next decades. I don't know if next year it's going to happen, but I do believe that both of those things will be guaranteed to happen within the next 20, 25 years.
Especially when Uranus goes into Gemini and it's trining Pluto. Oh yeah, that's definitely something we'll probably see. We're gonna see like everything changing with technology, new different technology coming to front. Yeah,
I'll tell you my reasoning for saying that, which is that I believe that the energy of Eris is going to become more and more and more powerful in the world for like the next half century, and so. One of the key things that Eris is involved in is being able to see yourself the way other people see you, being able to understand yourself the way other people see you. So we're going to get aliens and we're going to find out how they see us, right? They're going to show up and be like, this is how we've been looking at you guys. And we're going to like, oh, damn. Like, you know, it's going to be like a revelation to see ourselves from the outside like that. And I think the same thing could happen with the inner earth stuff. I'm less aware of that, but I mean, I think the breakaway sounds pretty possible, pretty likely. Yeah. So
I don't think the inner earth beings want to ever be seen. The aliens are much more likely to be seen than inner earth beings. Inner earth beings are really timid. They want to be hidden and they don't want to be seen. They don't want to get involved with humans. They're really scared of us.
I don't know. They've already gotten involved with me. So I think that they're not like.
Well, you're special.
What I would say is that because of that energy I'm talking about, that even if they don't want to be seen, they will be. Like we will be, if they're there, we'll become aware of them, because that, the energy of that planet, which I understand that's not really like part of what people are used to talking about here, but that energy of that planet about sharing and mixing and extroverted, you know, getting to know the outside perspective on who you are. It's basically, if they're there, we will meet them during this time of like the next, you know, not necessarily 2023, but the coming decades for sure.
Maybe even when the node goes into Pisces, North Node goes into Pisces, like in 2026, 27. Then like we'll be open more to the spiritual, like immaterial, other reality, kind of, you know,
that's escape. Interesting. So. Can I say some stuff about the nodes real quick? Okay. So
yes, you may.
Okay, cool. Thank you. I just say like the nodes is like, it's like basically like an incoming lesson. And the North Node is like an incoming lesson. The South Node is a thing that we're letting go of. And the incoming lesson isn't always easy. The compulsion or the tendency is to gravitate towards the South Node. So, and when we talk, what we're talking about right now is the transiting North Node, where the North Node's moving. I think it's a very subtle thing. It's kind of like breathing. You're inhaling, you're exhaling. It's not always that easy to notice what's happening with the nodes, but the incoming lesson is there for that whole duration, right? So we're getting the North Node in Taurus right now, and we're in like the last third of it, right? So we're in the home stretch of it. And at some point we do kind of get that lesson and we learn to let go of that opposite thing. Right. So with that South Node's been in Scorpio, it's actually compulsively driving people more towards the Scorpio end of it. So Scorpio is not satisfied with the surface. It's digging under the surface. So they're like during this time of the North Node in Taurus, we're getting like lots and lots of microscopic examinations and not trusting. OK, lots. There's like a negative manifestation of Scorpio because it's on the South Node is like lots of paranoia. Not believing people, not taking people at face value, and then also lots of microscopic explorations of the virus, the vaccines, right? All that stuff is.
That stuff's not done yet.
I'm saying during this time,
you guys want to talk about Saturn and Neptune?
It's a compulsion.
I see.
It's a compulsion during that time, but we're getting the incoming lesson of Taurus is about enjoying the here and now and pleasant things, harmony. Is a Taurus thing, right? So Scorpio is like not satisfied with that. It's usually digging for something that's more intense. So we're the South Node in Scorpio, it tends to kind of drive people towards looking for their answers there, and then they find out that they're not getting them there, and then they accept the incoming lesson of Taurus. So it's a kind of a complicated thing. Like when the North Node goes into Aries, it's not like everybody's going to embrace their inner warrior and be very independent and courageous like the Aries. They're probably pretty likely to dig into the Libra side of them, where they're looking for luxury, you know, and escape and things. It's a very interesting transition of the nodes, because there's a Venus and Mars polarity between those signs that's going to flip. So the North Node in Taurus is a Venus lesson, and then the North Node in Aries is a Mars lesson. And the South Node in Scorpio, we're letting go of a Mars type energy. And the South Node in Libra, we're letting go of a Venus type energy. So that's a real, real subtle thing. But by the end of the cycle, we get our lesson. You know, it's like there's something that comes out of that in that year and a half thing for everybody in different ways. So
when's the end of that cycle?
Well, I guess it's July, right? When we're finally out of there, is that what it is? It's like
July 18th, the nodes shift, okay. Right? And that also, I wanted to bring up that when Venus, because Venus is in retrograde again, like, you know, the ruler of the South Node, and like you said, because the South Node is what we're so used to, it's hard for us to kind of push ourselves to North Node. South Node is actually stronger. The energy of the South Node is stronger for us, so that Venus energy is going to be even stronger. It's interesting when Venus goes into retrograde, it's actually going to be bringing up, like, because it's going to be at certain degree points of what happened on the solar eclipse of the 2017 solar eclipse then. Oh, yeah. It's going to be in that same position. So we'll be actually like really bringing up the last 5 to 6 years for review of what we went through. And, you know, we're having a solar eclipse here that's also going to be visible in the US in October.
Well, can I stop you for a second?
I thought that was in 2020.
I'm sorry. I just want to ask you because you just said something I had no awareness of. You're saying that the North Node, what's the thing that's going to match up with the 2017 eclipse? What's the thing
The Venus retrograde position.
Oh, like when
Venus retrogrades through Leo, like, in the same degree points that the solar eclipse was in 2017. Yeah.
Because that eclipse was like hell of a big thing. Mm-hmm. For
especially for us who live in the US, right? It's strongest where it's visible. Yeah. So wherever it's visible, it's where, so if you go travel to an eclipse and you're in the place where it's visible, you're going to feel the effect of that eclipse for sure. And since we're here in the US, it really affects the US. Across the US.
April 20th, Australia this year is having a full solar eclipse.
Like right overhead.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That's going to be really cool at 29 degrees Aries, actually. But the one here that's going to be visible in the US, actually, it's going to be visible in the US. It's going to be on October 14th. Yeah. It's going to be in Libra. So it'll be affecting anywhere you have 21 degrees in Libra in your chart. It'll be affecting you on, you know, in that
21
way.
Degrees?
21 degrees Libra. Oh, yeah, that's where the solar eclipse will be.
Those are my lunar nodes, is right there, actually.
Oh, wow. That's going to be really interesting for your destiny.
Yeah.
Is that your north node or south node?
My north node is like almost 22 of Aries.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah. So it'll be a south node. Yeah.
Okay. Very interesting.
Yeah. What?
Yeah, that's like more of a release of, you know, the past, a release of something that, or even bringing in something from the past that you've had, new skills bringing in. I mean, it can be coming in from the past, but so you're having a nodal reversal then this year, huh?
No, I'm getting a nodal return early next year.
Oh, next year.
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry, I got confused there.
It's the nature of the nodes. It's like that, right? It's pretty trippy.
Yeah. Yeah, for everybody who's not in the know about how the nodes run, they run backwards.
Mm-hmm. Good point.
Yeah. So they start at the 29th degree and they go all the way back to 00. It's like a reset, which is so interesting that term has been used in the past.
Great reset.
Oh, interesting. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Also, whatever you go through when you're having a nodal return is like actually it's your destiny. It's like destined. It's like destiny's meet. You're meeting destiny, and especially you're going to have a solar eclipse on that. Wow, your destiny is coming forward for you. That's really cool.
Not a minute too soon.
Can I say something really, really quick about the nodes that are going to be changing into going from North Node in Taurus to North Node in Aries? And south nodes as well. The best way to kind of like sum up very quickly, like the initial lessons that are going to be coming in with that changing of energy, south node in Libra is a releasing of codependencies across the board. When you release codependency, you shoot up to Aries, which is that independent, I am capable and I can do it. And it's that unapologetic taking up of space and sharing what you came here to share. So Nikki, that kind of answers your question earlier about when's it going to happen that, you know, what I was born for is going to be happening. Is it? I mean, it's happening right now and it's getting emphasized next year.
Well, I mean, in terms of one world mafia that we currently live under, like our political systems are funny. They're just like, they're not even worth like getting into. They're just stupid and funny. And like that's, and it's basically been like that since I've been an adult, voting adult. I don't know if it's been like that forever. I can't speak before I was a voting adult, but the last 20 years have been absolutely retarded in my mind's eye. So, and I know that's not a politically correct term, so maybe I should edit that out.
I use it all the time.
Okay, I know. That's sorry. But anyway.
Never for anybody who's got a real thing going on. It's just my application to myself more than anything.
I just think that it's like, I just feel like it's our political system has to change in our lifetime, because it just has to, because it's just funny at this point. And I don't know if that, I mean, I'm an anarchist, right? But I don't know like how, like what system would actually work for our level of consciousness or lack of level of consciousness, but that we collectively have. But yeah, right. Anyway, I feel like it's got to have some shift soon.
Well, I think as the United States loses its hegemonic power in the world, which is definitely happening, definitely happening, as it loses power, then the political systems that predominate in other countries will be more. So you're either going to get overt one party systems, or you're going to get multipolar, you know, where you get more than two. So that, I mean, it's really the United States that's held that thing out there for people, that you get the two party system is the way to go. And it's pretty clear that we're getting to the end of the viability. I mean, we've almost got a nakedly one party system here, you know, as the, this kind of, in terms of astrology, I would see that as a thing that's related to Pluto myself. Okay. But I mean, I don't expect anybody to agree with it, but it's just one of the symbols for Pluto is there's a thing called a bident, right? So like Neptune's got his trident, right, with the three prongs, right? And Pluto's got a thing with two prongs, right? And then he's got this circle in between that, which is like a cape, it's a cap of invisibility. So he's holding this thing out, and you've got your attention on these two things, and he's the kind of one who's in between it. You know, they're serving the same end. There's kind of really no difference.
It's the left and the right wing of the same bird, sort of.
Right.
Thing.
So we're moving into something that's more the Iridian, the thing that's the hegemony that's kind of based more on Eris than Pluto. Then we're getting a multipolar reality in the world. You know, and so the political system I don't expect actually any reform to the political system in America. I mean, actually with Pluto and Aquarius, we could definitely get it. So I don't want to rule it out, but I don't see logically, just from my little individual point of view right now, my knee jerk is to say that I don't see it, but we could definitely get it with Pluto and Aquarius. I want to backtrack as I'm saying that. So we could definitely get it then.
We definitely will get it. Yeah.
Good,
it's
going like
to break.
That.
It's going to break into more of a group think, maybe, you know, more of a parliament or something, if we can put it towards like our kind of 3D matrix system, like more that way than the top down.
So I'm going to just say real quick that when Pluto was in Capricorn is when we had the American Revolution. Right. And then when Pluto went into Aquarius is when we actually got the Constitution. So we can look at two different ways of looking at government, right? So the revolution was basically something that was brought on by all kinds of different scarcity issues, right?
Well, that's interesting, because that was like 250 something years ago or whatever.
Whenever it was, 1776, right? And then it was 17, I think it was like 1780 something. It was, Pluto was well into Aquarius by the time the Constitution actually was ratified. So it was a pretty long span of time.
Yeah, that's a really good point. Yeah.
Just going off of what you were saying. So,
To punctuate it, Val, you're absolutely correct. The America we know and we're born to and grew up with will not survive. It's going to die. And thank goodness. Very happy for that. Not to sound unpatriotic, but this system is not sustainable. It does not serve anybody except for. We're not going to get into that. So it's awesome. It's another revolution happening, but in a very different way. The art of revolution has changed from a very physical gun in hand, kick down a couple doors or, you know, go out and protest in front of big buildings, to more of like a cyber space kind of revolution situation, or getting even more localized with like grassroots. Like one of the greatest like revolutionary things you can do right now is grow your own garden and not go to the grocery store and not support those big industrial monocrop situations.
Also better for your health, probably.
Yes.
Great thing to do with the North Node in Taurus.
Yes.
If you try to grow your own garden right now, you've got the wind at your back with the North Node in Taurus for sure. Yeah.
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 Or like co-ops or individual, like, you know, group. I guess we're going to go into the group farming because it's really hard. You can't survive in a vacuum on your own with a backyard full of, I don't know, cucumbers and tomatoes.
True.
Like, I've been gardening the last 3 years, and like my carrots are like, you know, like the amount. Let's just say like your cucumber is like $47 and your carrots, like, I mean, the amount of water you water, the amount of stuff you do to them. This is not cheap. Gardening is not cheap. And the amount you lose and then the bugs.
Yeah, the amount of time it takes. Oh my goodness.
I'd like, rather
it's
go out
really important to start to collaborate. I mean, you can do all you want by yourself, but we cannot survive on our own. I mean, as much as this, you know, this Aries North Node is going to pull us, I mean, it's just going to be pulling us away from the, you know, the enmeshment we've been, that's been toxic, the toxic relationships we've been in, mm-hmm. the toxic, you know, like, dependency we've been in. That's really what it's going to do. But I mean, it comes down to farming, agriculture, and these require like a community at large as coming together, you know, to be able to pull that off, obviously. So it's interesting. I mean, oh, this brings me to remember when I talked about Jupiter being in Taurus. Well, guess what? I mean, I totally forgot that Jupiter is in retrograde, like almost like the last part of the year, from the beginning of September all the way to the end of the year. So that might show us a little bit about what's going to be taken away, right? Almost like Jupiter in Taurus in retrograde, like we're pulling back all of that, you know. Retrogrades, it starts retrograding September 4th, and it retrogrades all the way through the end of the year, like on December 30th or something like that. So like a lot of the time, Jupiter's going to be in retrograde there in Taurus. So it's going to be pulling back and making us see, oh, wait a second. I thought I had all of this and now I don't, I have to reassess. You know, I have to like make do. So it is interesting. So although we got, you know, that taste of lavish life and then it pulls back. So I think that'll be interesting at the end of the year. The end of the year is a lot of like really intense energy too with, the sun is closely conjuncting Mars for like a couple of months from November all the way through December. Mars and the sun are really closely conjunct. So
they're moving along with each other at the back.
Yeah.
Like back stretch.
It's going to be helping us power through and getting that energy we need to move through almost like a surplus of energy. So even though our resources will be pulled back, we'll have the energy then to start to make shifts and changes or whatever we need to do.
So Mars is going to be moving pretty fast.
Yeah.
Throughout the year.
Through the end
of
the year.
It's been so long in the retrograde.
Right? Yeah.
Getting more notice as it. Yeah. Cool.
Yeah. We'll have more energy finally. Yeah.
Yeah. I just love retrogrades. I'm sorry. I'm that guy. I like, you know, the downside is always, I don't know. I still like it. You know?
Well, it makes you really sit in retrospective. It makes you really
maybe that's just because I'm that type. Yeah, maybe I like that. Yeah. I'm a rehasher. You know?
I'm a doer. I like. I need it to go direct.
Yeah, I'm a doer. But yeah. That probably explains it. Yeah.
Okay. So 2023. Is there anything else that we didn't touch on that you guys need to tell us about, like 2023, like, you know, what about travel? Is that going to, I mean, my wings, I'm a huge traveler, and my wings were clipped during the COVID BS. And like, I'm looking to do a lot more traveling this year. So I hope they don't put lockdowns on that again, ever again, but hopefully. What do you think about all that? Anything with that?
So there's an interesting move that is going to be attempted, and it's not just in 2023. There's also something set for 2025 reportedly, where you can kind of use 2019, the tail end of 2019, and all of those exercises that were done and all those meetings and workshops that were done at the end of 2019 to prepare for a future situation that came about in March of 2020. I'm seeing the way the astrology is configuring itself, there's something similar happening again like that, where there's this echo kind of rhythm going on with the end of 2022 and spring of 2023. That is why I was saying before that 2023 appears to me to be something like 2020 on steroids, but it's different. It's a different setting. It's a different narrative, but the rhythm is similar. With that being said, there are some things I'm kind of tracking about this galvanization of emotional energy towards saving the planet, environmentally speaking, and blaming the populace for the pending destruction. And so wanting to get proactive now about that, potentially in the form of lockdowns. So there's a potential there that I'm seeing, especially with Saturn moving into Pisces. There's a lot of economic shifting that I'm seeing as a result. Saturn in Pisces, one of the forms it can take is homelessness. Mm. So it's got this lockdown signature as well as a homelessness signature, which is a very interesting mix of energies. It almost seems like a paradox. So I'm not 100% clear about how that's going to unravel or unfold, but I am seeing that. And I feel it pertains to your question about travel. So it's like a yes and no answer.
Like, get it out of the way at the beginning of the year.
Well, I'm just going to encapsulate it this way. Don't make any plans for the spring, because there are a lot of shifting plates and spinning plates as they're shifting in the spring. I wouldn't get caught up in that tizzy of energy, not to mention all the stelliums, which means there are at least three, but usually more planets in the same sign, which is really boosting and emphasizing that energetic expression. So there's a stellium in Pisces in March that is big, releasing energy, but that can also make you feel a little more tired. So you might not even have enough energy to go out on that adventure, but you can still travel. And then there's a stellium in Aries towards the end of that, which moves into Taurus. I mean, it's like one stellium right after the other. Mm. It's kind of like marching in formation. The planets are doing that. And that creates another kind of energy, the Aries energy. That's a birth energy. That's not a rebirthing, because that would be more Scorpio. It's like a birthing, like a crowning of the child coming out. And a birth, if you've ever been present or ever seen one on YouTube or, you know, wherever, it's a chaotic scene. There's a lot going on, many elements shifting. So again, even though there's that Aries energy, which gives a lot of energy and forward movement, I still would advise not moving physically with that in that sense, in the form of travel. I wouldn't advise that, because again, there's a lot still working itself out. And then we have Taurus. Taurus, by this time we're into April, so we're still in spring. Taurus, it's more of a homebody energy. It's more of a, I'm going to go out to the backyard and, you know, work my garden and, you know, just really take in spring and connect with the earth and get all earthy, and then kind of go in and eat a really good meal and pop my chocolate in and have a good cup of tea and just enjoy, meditate, you know, that kind of thing. Not to say that Tauruses can't travel. It's just, again, with that emphasis on energy, I would not advise it until after we get through those stelliums. in the spring. The rest of the year, I mean, North Node moving into Aries. Wow.
That's cool.
That's cool. Yeah. I was thinking of one thing that I do want to mention for 2023. Mm-hmm. Is it cool? Yeah. Because we got Pluto square Haumea. There's not a whole lot of talk about it, but my view of it is that it's really manifesting very clearly in the supply chain blockages. So if you could think, really, there's almost no talk about Haumea, so I don't want to get lost in it, but just metaphorically, just think of it. It's like a birth or analogy. It's like a birth canal. Okay. And it, but it also is kind of like a canal, just like a regular canal, like where goods go through. Okay. It's just how stuff gets from one place to another. And it is been square with Pluto. It's squared with Pluto in the first time. I can't remember when it was, but I think the exact square was like in maybe May. Oh, no, it was the first week of May of this year, of 2022, the exact square. It's been in a square for several years, like within orb, and it's going to continue to be within orb of a square with Pluto for the rest of the decade. But these exact squares are some pretty intense hits. So we're getting an exact square in two new signs. So they've been in older, they previously was in a square with Libra and Capricorn. And that was wrapping up a bunch of different things in cardinal signs throughout, like that started way back in 2010. And now we're moving into fixed signs, maintaining the same aspect. And that is a very unusual thing with outer planets, very distant dwarf planets, holding this aspect as they move forward into two new signs, each of them moving into new signs together, holding the square and then maintaining it. So, you know, that supply chain thing, the availability of goods and difficulties getting things from one place to another is going to be a major theme this coming year. It's probably going to be intensified compared to where it was this year. That's why I say, I think of 2022 as being the last normal year for people that are living like a first world life, you know, where the availability of goods is something they just don't have to think that much about. And with Pluto in Aquarius, it's like, we will probably find a way to, I'm not saying it's going to be a problem without a solution, but it is going to be a challenge. You know, it's going to be a thing that people are going to have to reckon with. Sorry.
Yeah, that's really interesting. We're going to have to go through a lot of shifts and changes. And I would like to answer your question about traveling. People are going to travel if they're going to travel. Buy travel insurance. It's really important to buy travel insurance this coming up year, because the thing is with supply chains, what he's saying, planes breaking down, parts breaking up, you know, like they can't get replacements like they used to. Again, with this kind of, you know, supply chain or things that are backed up, you can't fix things like you can used to quickly. So things are going to get constantly changed. Travel is going to get constantly changed. So buy that insurance and be prepared to shift and change every itinerary because of that. So that's what my suggestion would be. I don't think it's like, he's right, it's never going to come back to normal. Like if anything, we may again have to like come up with new inventions of travel, because these planes, Nikki, you know, with the plane situation, like we're having major issues with planes these days. Like a lot of companies are going to go under a lot. We're going to see Amazon perhaps go under, which is going to be so shocking.
Okay. Definitely.
Wow. Anything that involves traveling with shipment or anything like with moving parts that have to do with, you know, a structure and infrastructure, things that need to be fixed and corrected, like, you know, any maintenance that is necessary, all of the things like that, we're going to see just kind of collapse and just go through like a chaos. So that's why insurance is really important right now.
So that's a thing that has to do with the astrology for this year coming?
I mean, I sense it. I don't know. Okay. I can't pinpoint exactly what planetary aspects are causing that.
Okay.
You know, I would put my money on this year, actually, because that's when Pluto moves back into Capricorn.
I know. It's the moon that's moving in and out of Aquarius. Okay. That's, I mean, devastating monopoly. Obviously, but we're just pinning everything on Pluto at this point. So it's like, okay, throw that one on there too, I guess.
Well, I mean, thank you, Pluto. It's cleaning it up.
I mean, cataclysms, that's one of them, right? It's
well, that's actually what I wanted to say about Val's point too. These shortages, this disruption in supply chain,
especially too.
Yeah, yeah. If you take a step back and look at what these shortages are, you'll notice a pattern. It's a lot of processed foods are being just, and processed foods are terrible for you and your body. And that's going to really be coming out as they are deceased, as they no longer are going to be able to be manufactured. FDA, all that stuff is gone.
That makes sense. Anything manufactured, that's the key word right there as I'm talking about vacuum. Anything manufactured or needs maintenance, we're going to see that kind of go into chaos.
This is the collapse of the industrial era. And thank you. So happy that this is happening because it was really putting a strain on health. Find a
new job, Nikki.
Okay, so that's fine too. We don't need to give in to fears about it because these changes are to be embraced and celebrated because we're heading into this whole era of total unique liberation in which you're able to express a job doesn't exist. Create it. Create your own job. Let machines take over, like, you know, menial, mundane tasks and everything. Let it happen and focus on more human-centric ways of being. I honestly don't even believe that jobs, paid situations are going to be necessary that much further down the road. I think that that whole thing is-
It's very UBI.
Not like that though, but getting paid to exist through this connection on energy and money, getting more liberated from this.
Obviously more freelancing will have to be necessary.
Using your unique gifts and offering them to the public and then getting resources in return. Not necessarily. I wonder if you could
freelance.
Though.
Yeah. Freelance is a big thing. I think this next year. For sure.
It sounds scary only because we're coming from a certain structure and it can be difficult and challenging to think outside of that structure. But hey, you're going to anyway, as soon as those walls get torn down, because there is no structure to think inside anymore. You see the horizon, you see all of the trees around you, all the foliage, everything that you've been, because we didn't have windows and doors in that structure. We really didn't. It was the crazy ones, you know, blew up a wall and got out that were like, hey guys,
right,
check it out.
That's really interesting. Huh. Okay. Yeah. Well, does everybody feel like they've completed 2023 or is there anything else? Cause if not, I'm going to have you guys all introduce your, like how they can find you.
I mean, there's lots, so of course. There's like, it's never ending with this stuff, but I think it's
what astrology is. You never arrive.
Okay, cool. Well, let's just go around and everybody tell everybody how they can find you and what you offer, like as your unique gift. So Riley, you go first.
Okay. With like name and everything, or
just be like, you know, like where, what's your website, how to, like you do astrology readings, like whatever.
Yeah, sure. Okay. So you can find me at spiralupastrology.com. I offer a bunch of different, tailored and personal readings. The one I would recommend getting is the natal birth chart reading, because it's the most essential piece of information you could possibly have in your tool belt right now. And that is, it's information about you, who you are, what you came here to do, what you're doing, all your gifts, talents, abilities, et cetera. And so I highly recommend doing that. And then just having fun with other readings too, because it's just fun. I love
that. What about you, Miara?
Okay, so you can find me at Awakened Aspects. I'm Miara Rose, awakenedaspects.com. I'm on Instagram at Awakened Aspects. I have a YouTube channel, Awakened Aspects. I do offer personal natal astrology readings, both pre-recorded and live sessions. I'm also a quantum healer. I do provide beyond quantum healing hypnosis technique, and I do take people into regression. I've been doing a combination of both as well, which has been really fun. And you can find me at all of those. So check me out.
And you, Val?
The best way is really... I hate to do this, but this is the reality. It's just, you could just basically contact me at my email, which is distancebetweenplanets@gmail.com. Then I have a website, distancebetweenplanets.com, but I really haven't done anything with it. I'm a lazy, flaky guy, basically. I'm good at readings. That's how it works. So I do psychic readings, clairvoyant readings. That's sort of the majority of my business, but I've been studying astrology for 30 years. And I do individual horoscopes. I'm also a human design person. So I give human design readings. And I've been onto human design for almost 20 years. So I got my own thing. I'm just a fun, flaky guy to get a reading from. So I give good readings. I do give good readings.
Yeah, you do. I've had readings. They're good. They're accurate.
If you do say so yourself.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's the only thing I can really say with certainty nowadays is that is, I am very good at that. Yes.
Yeah, you are. You're very good at that. And so is I have not had Riley. Riley, I need to. I'm gonna do a thing with you. But Miara and Val are both like amazeballs. So I know that to be true from experience. So there you go. Okay, you guys, let's just end it here, and let's just like hope for the best. For thank you guys for giving us a, you know, like a watch out for this. Don't do this on this. This could happen. Like, you know, it was a good little forecast for 2023. Let's hope it's a good one.
Thank you. Thanks so much, everybody. Thanks for telling me about flight insurance, that travel insurance. that's I need that. So thank you.
Yeah. Worth it. Worth it. Thanks, Nikki.
All right. Bye, guys.